When the Buddha talks about how he discovered the path, he starts with right concentration. He'd been trying different methods for years. Nothing worked. He'd pretty much exhausted all the alternatives that were known in those days. And then he remembered that he'd entered into concentration when he was a child, spontaneously, with a sense of ease, refreshment. And he asked himself, could that be the path? And there was a realization that came in and said, yes. Then the question is, why am I afraid of that? Pleasure and ease. That has no drawbacks. So he decided to follow that path. And then he developed the other factors around it. It's interesting to note, though, that together with right concentration, there came some, at least the beginning of right view. The concentration was at least one of the factors of the path. And the fact that these came together may explain why the Buddha would emphasize concentration in some of his explanations of the path. There's one where he calls it the center of the path, and all the other factors are its supports. And there are others where he talks about right view as being the seed for all the other factors. The point being that the first and the last factors of the path are the really important ones. And so as you practice, you want to keep both in mind. Right view, of course, is the view that, to begin with, that your actions really do make a difference. There are skillful actions and there are unskillful actions. The skillful ones, when you develop them, would lead to happiness. The unskillful ones will lead to suffering. And the Buddha has you practice in line with that particular insight by following the precepts. And the precepts point to your intentions. You can break a precept only intentionally. So even though they are focused on what you do in terms of your speech and your physical actions, the real focus is on the mind. So you get to know your intentions. This gets you ready for concentration practice. And also right view in the sense that your intentions are going to be really important in determining whether you act in a way that leads to suffering or act in a way that leads away from suffering. So again, the importance is with the mind. And then we get to the Four Noble Truths, which are the transcendent level of right view. Here everything is internal. Suffering is clinging to the aggregates. The body may grow ill, old, die. But that's not the essence of the suffering. As John Lee says, those are the shadows of suffering. But the real suffering is the clinging to the aggregates. Form, feeling, perceptions, thought constructs, consciousness. The clinging is the big problem. That's the suffering. And what causes it? The three kinds of craving, which are things that you do. And you can attack those three kinds of craving by doing other things, in other words, following the path, starting with right view, all the way through right concentration, under the headings of virtue, concentration, discernment. And through that path, it's possible to put an end to suffering. Now, it's an internal job. The suffering is inside, the causes are inside, the solution is inside. So suffering may be the focal point of right view. But it also tells you something more than just how suffering happens and how it ends. It also tells you that this is the big issue in life. This should have top priority. And this is where the Buddhist teachings go really contrary to the world. We live in a world where the big issues are outside. And the media keep pointing our attention over there, over there, over there. Whereas the Buddha said, no, the place you really should pay attention is in here. So as you practice in the world, you have to realize that your priorities are going to have to be different from the priorities of the world. It's in this way that the Dharma is countercultural, not only here in the West, but wherever it's found. A lot of things the Buddha did and said were really opposed to Indian culture at the time. Old Brahmins were upset because the Buddha wouldn't bow down to them. Other people were upset because their sons and daughters were ordaining, leaving the family and going into the homeless life. So it wasn't that he was just adopting Indian views or adopting Indian customs. He was going against them. And in every culture where you find that Buddhism is spread, it is countercultural, primarily because its priorities are different. Ajahn Mun got a lot of flack when he went out into the forest, followed the Dhyanga practices, really devoted himself seriously to the practice. That was back in the day when monks were supposed to be the village doctors, the village teachers. The government was trying to get them to lead a settled life. So he had to escape, first to the forests of the northeast, then to the forests of the northern part of Thailand. And even there he was accused of not following Thai customs or Laotian customs. But as he said, he was interested in joining the noble ones. So he had to follow the customs of the noble ones, which were not the customs of the Laos or the Thais or any nationality. Because national customs, the usual civilization of human beings, is the civilization based on greed, aversion, and delusion. It's based on defilement. Its priorities are all different. So as you take on the practice, you have to realize you're changing your priorities. And you're going to have to step outside of your culture. I noticed this is one of the things I appreciated with John Fung when I first met him. He wasn't a typical Thai. He spent time in the forest. And when you're in the forest, you can look back on the society that you've left. And you can see it from the outside. Of course, he did have some attitudes that were very Thai, but they had been questioned. And they're not just adopted out of habit. They were adopted because there were some things in Thai culture that were in line with the Dharma. But the Dharma came first. And the issue of why you're suffering and how you're suffering and what you can do to put an end to it, that had to have top priority. Which meant that he had to step out of the society. There might have been initially a sense of alienation, but also there was a sense of freedom that he was freed from the strictures of that society. And so as we approach our practice here, we have to take the same approach, that our priorities are different from the world around us, and we hold on to them because they are liberating. We just fall in line with what the world says is important. Find it harder and harder and harder to even find time to practice, much less have a consistent practice or one that progresses. So always try to keep that in mind. The issue of what suffering is and how you're causing it and how you can put an end to it, that should have top priority. You want to look into your mind and see how your mind is processing things, because that's what the Four Noble Truths are all about. Sights, sounds, smells, tastes, tactile sensations can be good or bad. But the fact that they're good or bad doesn't mean that they're going to have to make you happy or have to make you sad. It's how you process them that makes the difference. Now, there are some things will come in from your past karma. As the Buddha said, you want to see the eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind as the results of past karma, the things you experience through these senses, the results of past karma. But you don't just put up with whatever. It's like going into your kitchen and finding that you have nothing but raw eggs in your refrigerator. Now, you may not have wanted raw eggs that day, but that's what you've got. But you don't have to eat them raw. You can cook them, you can steam them, you can do all kinds of things with them. And the more skills you develop, the more the alternatives are, the more the possibilities are. So it's the same as you develop the skills of the path, as you develop the skills of mindfulness, alertness, ardency, concentration, discernment. These give you more and more options. So in the beginning you get better at the very least, alleviating suffering. And when you really master these skills, then you find a dimension where there is no suffering at all. Now the world doesn't believe in that possibility. And as we see the Dharma coming to the West, there's so many people who try to close off that possibility, even in the Dharma. But you have to decide for yourself, are you going to keep that possibility as an open option? And are you going to order your priorities in line with that? The Buddha and all the noble disciples said that's a really worthwhile attitude to have. And so you want to take them as your models and think of your life as being scrutinized by them. The question is not, how do you appear in the eyes of the world? But how would you appear in the eyes of the noble ones? The noble ones have high standards, but they also have a lot of compassion. And they realize that by holding you to those high standards, that's the compassionate approach. So when you adopt their standards, you adopt their priorities. It may put you at odds with the world sometime. But then what is the world? Gain, loss, status, loss of status, praise, criticism, pleasure, pain. All of this gets swept away. If you want to find something that doesn't get swept away, you want to give priority to right view. And then what right view tells you about your actions, what's important in life, what's not, take that to heart and make that your guide.